two-dimensional vectors, level 4. In this video, we will learn about vector operations. This is also known as vector arithmetic. Many problems that make use of vectors require slightly more complicated calculations other than just finding the magnitude of a vector. In order to carry out these calculations, we need to learn algebraic operations with vectors. These vector operations are carried out similar to algebraic operations with real numbers. Before we start, we need to remember that a vector represents a directed line segment with a specific length, known as the magnitude, and a specific direction. We will be using this geometric representation of a vector to illustrate various vector operations geometrically. You can think about this vector as representing the displacement of a particle that starts at one point, the initial point, like point A, and ends at the second point, the terminal point, like point B. This type of vector is referred to as a displacement vector in physics. This vector can be denoted the same way we denoted vectors in the previous videos, by using the initial and terminal point with an arrow on top, as follows, vector AB. Or, we can also name the vector by using a single boldface letter with an arrow on top. Alright, let's go over the first vector operation. Our first vector operation is a scalar multiplication. This operation consists of multiplying a vector by a real number c. This operation can be denoted as c times vector v. The real number c is referred to as a scalar. Note that a scalar is not a vector, so we need to make sure we don't write an arrow on top, like we do with vectors. This way, we can distinguish a scalar from a vector. As the name suggests, scalar multiplication of a vector can be geometrically viewed as scaling a vector by a specific factor. This can either stretch or compress the original length of a vector. It can also change the direction of a vector. For example, say you wanted to double the length of a vector. If this vector represents the displacement of a particle between two points, and if we wanted a particle to move twice as far in the same direction as vector v, we would denote this vector as 2 times vector v. Here, the number 2 is the scalar, and it's essentially instructing us to take vector v and double the length, making sure we keep the same direction in the process. In the same manner, if you want to reduce the length of vector v by half, we would denote it as follows, 1 half times vector v. Here, the scalar is 1 half, and it is instructing us to take vector v and reduce its length by a half, and keeping the same direction. Lastly, a vector can be multiplied by a negative scalar. Multiplication by a negative scalar forces the original vector to point in the opposite direction. This operation is denoted as negative vector v. It literally turns a vector 180 degrees in the opposite direction. In general, the scalar multiple of a vector v by a scalar c is the vector whose length is the absolute value of c times the length of vector v, and whose direction is the same as vector v. If c is greater than 0, in this case, a positive scalar, and the direction will be opposite to vector v if c is less than 0, in this case, a negative scalar. Note, if the scalar c equals 0 or vector v equals 0, then it follows that c times vector v equals 0. In the end, real numbers essentially work like scaling factors. This is why they are conveniently referred to as scalars. Now let's think about a different scenario. Say that a particle moves from point A to point B. Then, the particle changes direction and moves from point B to point C, with position vector BC. The combined effect of these movements is that the particle has moved from point A to point C. We can represent this movement by drawing a vector from point A and ending at point C, as follows. The displacement vector AC is essentially the sum of vector AB and vector BC. We can mathematically denote this sum as follows. Vector AC equals vector AB plus vector BC. In general, if we start with vectors V and U, we can geometrically find the sum of these two vectors by first moving vector U, making sure we do not change its magnitude or direction, so that its tail coincides with the head or tip of vector V, as follows. We can then define the sum, vector V plus vector U, as the vector whose initial point coincides with the initial point of vector V and extends to the terminal point of vector U. This vector is usually referred to as the resultant vector. The resultant vector is used extensively in fields such as physics and engineering, and its interpretation depends on the particular application it is being used for. In this example, the resultant vector represents the displacement of a particle from point A to point C. This method of adding vectors is sometimes called the tail-to-head method, or triangle law. This is the general procedure to add vectors geometrically. An alternative method of adding vectors is by just reversing the order in which you add both vectors. For example, say we wanted to add vector U plus vector V, as opposed to vector V plus vector U. Then we follow the same procedure. We take vector V and move it so that its tail or initial point coincides with the tip or head of vector U, and define the sum vector U plus vector V as the vector that starts from the initial point of vector U and terminates at the tip of vector V. Notice that we obtain the same resultant vector. In other words, vector V plus vector U equals vector U plus vector V. Notice that we also form a parallelogram. This illustrates yet another way of adding vectors geometrically. All we need to do is to move vector U and vector V so that they start at the same point. Then, the resultant vector lies along the diagonal of the parallelogram, with U and V as sides. This technique is referred to as the parallelogram law. Either technique can be used to find the sum of two vectors. If we wanted to add three or more vectors, we can essentially just apply each law multiple times. For the most part, it is a lot easier to use the triangle law when adding three or more vectors together. For example, if we had a third vector, say vector W, and wanted to find the sum of vector V, U, and W, we would first start with vector V and move vector U so that its tail coincides with the tip of vector V. Then, we would move vector W so that its tail coincides with the tip of vector U, as follows. Then, the resultant vector will be the vector that starts from the initial point of vector V and terminates at the tip of vector W. Again, the order in which the vectors are added does not matter. In the end, you should obtain the same resultant vector. Now let's move along to vector subtraction. Computationally, subtraction of vectors is very similar to vector addition. We can geometrically find the difference of two vectors by making use of the triangle law. Say we want to find vector V minus vector U. The easiest way to think about vector subtraction is by treating it as a vector addition problem. In other words, we want to find vector V plus negative vector U. So we take vector U and align its initial point with the tip of vector V. Normally, this is what you would do if you were adding both vectors. In the case of vector subtraction, we want to take the negative of this vector. Recall that a negative scalar flips the vector in the opposite direction. So we go ahead and change the direction of vector U as follows. Then, we can define vector V plus negative vector U as the vector whose initial point coincides with the initial point of vector V and extends to the terminal point of negative vector U. Again, similar to vector addition. We can also use the parallelogram law to find the difference. All we need to do is to make sure we change the direction of vector U so that it faces in the opposite direction. Then we align both vectors so that they start at the same initial point. The resulting vector will lie along the diagonal of the parallelogram, with negative U and V as sides. A final way to think about vector subtraction is by aligning both original vectors so that they start at the same initial point. Then we can use the fact that if we were to take vector u and add it with vector v minus vector u, we should obtain vector v. This way, we can use the triangle law to draw vector v minus vector u. In this case, the resulting vector would be drawn as follows. Personally, the first method for finding the difference between two vectors makes the most sense, but you're free to use any of these three methods when geometrically finding the difference between two vectors. Also, keep in mind that vector subtraction is just a special case of vector addition. If you were to have three or more vectors and are asked to carry out a combination of addition and subtraction operations with them, you treat the entire problem as if it were a vector addition problem by using the triangle law and flipping the direction of any vector with a negative sign. Alright, in our next video, we will go over various examples that make use of vector operations.